Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to A Fireside Chat with Zany Mystic. I am your host, Lance White. Tonight, I'm delighted to have Beverly Wilson return for part two of our exploration into the crystalline realms. Beverly is the owner of Mount Shasta's Middle Earth, the Crystal Room. She teaches classes and instructs people from around the world. And tonight, we're going to explore, among other things, what the crystals and others are sharing about the present shifts in energies and consciousness, along with some projections about the Mayan prophecies about 2012. So let's welcome Beverly to the show now. And I will say, hi, Beverly, how are you?
Great, it's great to be back.
Oh, good, wonderful. Well, before we get digging into some deeper topics, maybe you could just briefly get us started by an overview of what crystals are and how their consciousness can guide us.
Well, physics has, besides indigenous cultures, physics has proved that they're living consciousness. And what we do at the Crystal Room is just have the crystals' work be as important as the person's work. And so what we're doing is like shepherding the person to get together with the crystal that does the same work they do. And at that point in time, then whether the crystal and the person worships planets, solar systems, galaxies, universes, angelic realms, interdimensional, it doesn't matter. The work that they're doing and the scope that with which they have that work matches with the crystal, and they both get to be optimum to what they do.
Yeah, wow. Now, on a practical level, I didn't ask you this the last time, but this is a real simple thing that I'm sure people wonder about, and we each have our different answers and solutions to it, but from your viewpoint, what is one of the best ways to program, and then what about cleansing crystals?
Well, I know people are involved in programming crystals, and using the same work. If the crystal does the same work, to me, it isn't in the crystal's or the person's best interest to try and program a crystal that doesn't do that work. Okay, so that's not being respectful, and it just is like asking someone who is, you know, doesn't know how to tap dance to tap dance. Anyway, this is our train.
Oh, I love
this. This is Mount Shasta.
I love the sound of the train.
Anyway,
right there at Mount Shasta. So go on.
So basically, when a crystal does the same work, you can set the intention that it facilitate you in whatever way that is,
okay.
And that would be, you know, asking it. I don't see in my worldview, programming has the connotation that we're better than it is, and it's supposed to do what we want it to do.
Right, right.
You know, and I don't have that thought form.
Right.
So, to me, it's a co-partnership. Once you work with a crystal that really does your work,
uh-huh.
You co-partner with it in doing it. So it's taking on certain tasks that, or accents and focuses on certain tasks that you're going to, like a quartz crystal is a really good transmitter.
Uh-huh.
So you want to transmit that consciousness through it. It is just using it in the way that it does, that it works.
Yeah.
You know, the same way that we pick up a telephone and we talk to each other on the phone.
Right.
It isn't, we don't have to make the telephone be a telephone to do that.
Right. That makes sense to me. I have some crystals. I had cleansed them. I actually left them out way too long. They were over-baked out in the sun and in the moon and the rain and everything. But I brought them back in. I have some quartz crystals and some other ones. And my own feeling is that, you know, I just let them be. Now, I may not know precisely what purposes they serve. Some of them are quite extraordinary. If I have a chance to bring some of these up and ask you next time, or of course, you can douse these too, can't you?
Mm-hmm.
Using the yes-no function. But they're beautiful crystals, and some rutilated quartz. I have a clear quartz crystal here, and I have a couple of Herkimer diamonds, and, you know, they're just, I love them, so.
Exactly.
I don't care what they're
helping. Well, and basically they're working with you.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And as far as clearing and cleansing them.
Oh, yeah.
For me, the easiest way to do it with any crystal or any mineral is with using cosmic gold and its essence colors. But first I blaze it with a violet flame or clear it. You can neutralize and remove anything that isn't in its highest good,
mm-hmm.
in its highest form of expression.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't. I very rarely. I mean, if a crystal wants to take a bath, I'll give it a bath. Don't get me wrong. but I very rarely use a salt solution or anything. For some crystals, it's very damaging. For some minerals, it's very damaging.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I rarely use a.
Like a sea salt.
A type of cleansing aspect.
Right.
I use energy and intention. And then after I've cleared it, I use cosmic gold.
Uh-huh.
And the easiest way for me to describe cosmic gold is to go outside in the sun with something gold, and there's this absolute shimmer that hovers above it.
Uh-huh.
And that's the close. It's like an iridescent shimmer.
Mm.
And it's like the old gold fireworks.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And that's the easiest way I can describe cosmic gold. And then you don't have to know its essence colors. It knows its essence colors. You just give the intention that it receives it.
Right. And they've been around long before we were.
Right.
And will be around after we're here.
Exactly.
So to them, we're just like the flash of a light bulb going off, if that.
Exactly. And but they appreciate and love our consciousness. And very often through lifetimes, we work with similar crystals, if not the same crystals, depending on the crystal.
They use those in, I read in stories about Atlantis and the rest, that they were using crystals for advanced technology
So are we.
And so do we.
So are we.
So are we.
Yeah.
But we're not using them to the extent that they were used then, are we?
Or thank God.
Yeah. That kind of brought their civilization down, didn't it?
Well, the consciousness brought the civilization down.
Okay.
And we've had cycle after cycle after cycle. From one consciousness level to another consciousness level,
uh-huh.
one part of the earth, China, another part of the earth, the Egyptian, another part of the earth, Mid-Eastern, another part of the earth, every single part of the earth, the Himalayas, as that culture developed in the Mayans, as that culture developed Quetzalcoatl in Mexico, as that culture developed and then seemed to recede, it looks like a loss, but in my worldview, it's like the earth having all those parts activated. Now we're at a point where we activate the whole, she's activating herself as a whole, and we're activating ourselves as whole world consciousness.
Well, now that kind of brings us into the general topic that I wanted to get into tonight, and that was the... You know, what's going on with the shifts in energies and consciousness, and, you know, from what your experience, what have you seen over the years, and what do you see arriving, and also about the concept of the Mayan prophecy about 2012 being the peak of that period.
Well, 2012 is as far as the consciousness covered from where it was being written. Okay, so... For me, it is a huge shift, and actually there's a new crystal that's come in that is actually termed 2012 that has a level of consciousness that defies imagination.
Really?
And it really they're very simple. They're not big elaborate crystals, but they hold that absolute. It's a freedom. It's an unlimited. Consciousness,
oh.
freedom that I think we're moving toward in the shift that we're in now, as we let go of the old ways, old thoughts, old forms, and we move into what I call true creatrix compliance, creatrix, meaning it's not about creator, it's not about creatress. That's in the split. But it's as a unified consciousness that isn't split, and that X at the end kind of represents that unified consciousness as one.
Oh.
And so as we move into that consciousness and we let go of the old ways, old means, separations, traditional reactions rather than actions, we're moving into a new paradigm. We're moving into a new frequency inner relationship with all that is. And taking in on our creative co-partnership with all that is in what that means. Because as we move out of the lower densities of fear, doubt, not claiming who we are, looking outside of ourselves to try and be who we are,
as we
move into the clearest, authentic representation of our individual aspect of Source, everything shifts.
Yeah.
And that's what the Earth is doing. I mean, Gaia is claiming her right to be the clearest expression she can as we are.
So she's moving up in density as well, right?
Or out of density.
Out of the density.
Into a frequency. It's like, for instance, with amethyst, we say don't put it in the window because it's going to air it in the past thought forms. Don't put it in the window because it'll fade.
Okay.
Well, it's not really fading. It's just moving into a light frequency that we don't see.
Oh, okay.
You know?
Yeah, that makes sense.
And so all of a sudden it looks clear.
Right.
It's just gone beyond a frequency we receive.
Right. We see it as being, as fading.
Right.
Okay, I get you. And so that's what's happening to us.
Exactly.
And are we, I read a lot on the internet about, you know, various channels and materials and stuff that say that we're moving into, our DNA is shifting and we're moving into a more crystalline form. That we're being reprogrammed and rewired. Is that part of this whole process that you are talking about now?
I experience it as that, and as taking in just being the place as we clear our old reactions, ways of doing things, as we let go of what it means to have that response, and we raise the consciousness of what that means to a new response, or we let go of the whole thing altogether.
Ugh.
Even better.
Yeah. Yes.
Everything shifts, and we don't have to go through a gazillion years to do it. We can do it in intention is everything.
Huh.
We have to reinforce it in each moment we're in.
Right.
When we make the choice, and that is that brings it into the physical, in a way it can't, on a spiritual level. That's why we come here, is so we can embody what we know here.
Uh-huh. And coming here is we undergo the forgetting process or the veil.
Otherwise, we wouldn't, you know.
There wouldn't be any point to it.
Right.
Why don't we just cut to the chase and just be where we are and forget about all this middleman stuff?
Well, it makes it simpler.
Well, it seems like it would be. I mean, all the strife and the horrible things that are going on in the world. But, you know, we were talking about that earlier today, and... You had a nice analogy, and it was about the I think it was the C.S. Lewis story about moving into
C.S. Lewis in The Last Battle.
Yeah.
Where C.S. Lewis's fairy tales are really, I really love them, and in The Last Battle, there's this huge, huge battle, and when it's all over, there's this, like, doorway, and it doesn't look like, I mean, there's total space on either side, in walking through the doorway, as each individual walks through the doorway, they either find themselves in the biggest dung heap barn full of just dark, just miserable existence, or in the same doorway, the person experiences this amazing energy place, that panorama where it just gets getting bigger and better and bigger and better. And it's the consciousness that they were and that they bring with them that creates, you know, what we term as heaven and hell. You know, that only in that case it was a dung heap in the middle of it all.
Right.
And or just this amazing opportunity to enter into consciousness that just continues to expand, continues to get bigger, continues to get better.
And
clearer.
And part of the way that we are able to do that is by letting go of the lower vibrations and our fears and our beliefs and so on and so forth.
Right. And recognizing that they are there to serve us, to give us the opportunity to make that choice.
Yeah.
No matter how intense it is.
And it's probably going to get a little more intense, quote, out there, unquote, in the next couple of years.
Well, again, it's like parallel existences.
Yeah.
All of it happens at once. And whether we choose to experience it in a way where it continually builds into intensity, or we see it as the opportunity it is for us to claim our individual aspect of source in the minute we're in, to the maximum of clarity we can be in that moment, is what gives us our reality, in my worldview.
Okay. So when we see a reflection that is on the world stage that is clearly something that is not beneficial to human life, what is the highest way that we can transform that?
Well, there are some people that would have considered the Bush administration as a manifestation of that. And it has, you know, at this point in time, we're back to the biggest deficit we've ever had, and we're all living the gas prices, and the cost index of living is blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah. All of those are... I mean, the universe creates what we need and ask for.
Right.
You know, it can only give us what we ask for. We can be in exactly the same position and have it. Well, look at all the people who end up saying, and I didn't even know I was poor. You know, we had so much love in our family that it wasn't, although someone else would have the same thing and feel lack.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, so the things, the dramas that are playing themselves out, as I said earlier, I'm not a Pollyanna on any level, but the dramas play out so we can choose our response in conscious co-creation.
And how we respond, how we choose to respond to what the mirror is showing us affects what is showing us.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And that's quantum physics.
Yeah, right. Because it happens instantaneously because we're everywhere at once.
Exactly.
Well, we've solved the problems of the world.
Well, it isn't quite that simple because we live in this density.
Yeah.
We each moment is our choice to live it. It
right.
isn't solved outside of us.
Right.
We are the solution in the moment we're in.
And
as our vibration raises, as we don't buy into the illusion, as we don't look into the dragon of what seems to be so overwhelming,
right.
and we choose what in our heart of hearts is the best we can be in the moment we're in, we're raising the vibrational field to shift it.
Right. Kind of like holding the space for...
Proactively.
Yeah, right. And that requires a little bit of intention and effort, doesn't it?
It means not having any minute, not having any thought form, not having any impulse taken for granted.
Yes. So.
So that's work.
Yes.
But it's the best work we could ever do.
Right. Well, yes. It's kind of the purification process, as I see it.
It is the choice of bringing that consciousness into every single thought form, action.
Right, right, right.
Impulse.
And what doesn't match that
shows up. It falls away.
Falls away, yes. Yeah.
We only attract, that's the secret, the law of attraction.
Yeah.
We attract what we draw, what we send out.
Right, right. Didn't you mention a story? You just mentioned the dragon. Didn't you mention the story of Michael and the dragon?
Well, yeah, I said one of the my favorite examples of that always brings it to me is the story that if Michael had looked into the eye of the dragon,
uh-huh.
he wouldn't have been able to transform the dragon, but because he aimed with his heart and his knowing of the love of all that is. For itself, in whatever form it is, he was able to aim with his heart, and the dragon was transformed.
And that seems to say something about the need to see and embrace our own darkness.
Oh, absolutely. In my worldview, as we put our higher self in the center. We're used to thinking of a pyramidal worldview. I mean, we're brought up with it, where, you know, there's top dogs and everybody else either is crushed by it or supports it.
Right.
You know, but as we move into alignment with our higher self, our source self, that becomes the center of the circle, like a spoke. And every single aspect of who we are has its honored place on it. The things that we are the most refined, we came in with. The things that we try and brush under the carpet because we don't really want anybody to know that could possibly be real, are the ones that we came in to solve. They're our greatest teachers, and that those are the questions we follow through our lifetime and bring up again and again and again until we stop trying to run from them.
Can you give an example of that for greater clarity?
Just about anything in life is an example of that. When a pattern that we have in our family environment at the beginning that we live through over and over again. Like when my sister and I'm a twin, and she was very much involved with the physical world and she's wonderful. She's exquisite. She totally different. I mean, the physical world was often is my least dominant. And we used to say that, I used to say, well, you know, Maria, some people are meant to be Marthas and some people are meant to be Marys, you know, just as a reality of where our consciousnesses started and came from.
Uh-huh.
Through our lifetime, I mean, she was a home ec teacher, and very, very, very successful and in my family's, my mom and dad died in December, mom died in May, they were in their 90s, it was an incredibly wonderful celebration of each one of their lives, and she was the caretaker for them. In their last years, you know, and I knew when I was four that I was to love and respect my parents and my family and their worldview, but that my life was not determined by it.
Mm.
It would be influenced by it. It would be the point of reference from which I started, but it wasn't the totality of it or the limit of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so, I had an enormous amount of back roads, all of which come together in what I'm doing right now.
Uh-huh.
And there were times where my mom just said, oh, I don't want to know anything, you know. and I'm sure there were times where she was positive I was going to be swept away by some cult, even though that was her fear. It didn't have anything to do with me.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
right.
But and I could have tried not to be me and just said, okay, I'm going to comply and give away who I am.
Right.
but it wasn't an, I couldn't because, and so in some ways my life brought her, we used to joke that I put her in touch with every one of her prejudices and made him go beyond it, you know, because like when in her world at that time, anybody who was going to go into therapeutic massage was a prostitute. You know, she couldn't think of me as a prostitute, so in 1974, she had to change her thought form. You know?
That's funny.
That kind of thing.
Yeah, that's great. I love
that. And we reflect it over and over and over again until we actually get it and claim it.
Yeah.
But as I was saying, the center of the circle then becomes our worldview, our higher self.
Uh-huh.
And every single part has its honored place on the center. And learning to listen to the parts that don't have a very teeny voice because they've been shoved away, hidden, denied, not wanted to be looked at, or any of the other things we do.
Mm-hmm.
And where our mind, for instance, is like been top dog forever.
Right.
And it's always going to be in there trying to give some answers.
Right.
I just say thanks really much. I appreciate everything you've been and everything you do, and I'm listening to this part right now.
Right.
And this part is learning how to express itself and grow.
Yeah. In other words, what I hear you saying is to be in touch with your authentic self, your soul, basically, your spirit, and you know, who we really are, and you know, what we came to share or experience here in this realm.
In our own unique way.
Yeah.
And have it be just right. It doesn't matter what anybody else is.
Yeah.
One of my employees she's wonderful, and her dad was a Baptist minister, and she was brought up, and he just died, and she was brought up in that whole environment, once came to me, and she's a relatively new employee, and she was looking at me in disbelief and saying, well, don't you care what other people think? And I went, I mean, honestly and truly, I just looked at her blankly and said, why would I care what anybody thinks?
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean, how I can't,
right.
I can't control what somebody else thinks. All I can control is my truth in how I live the moment.
Right. You know, I had a good friend who was involved with a cult with a before I got into it, and we both ended up leaving it, but we were good friends for many years after that. She said she always used to worry about what everybody else was thinking about her. And she said one day she had this epiphany. She realized that the woman she was talking to was also worried about what she was thinking about her, and when that happened, she realized that there was no point in ever worrying again about what anyone was thinking about her, because everybody else was worried about what she was thinking about them anyway. So,
if you're only focused outward, that's the only place, that's the only way it can happen.
And if you're not focused outward, if you're living authentically, then that all becomes irrelevant.
Right, and your only job is to be the clearest expression you can be in the moment you're in.
Mm-hmm.
As transparent as you can possibly be.
Mm-hmm.
Because anything that is blocking it is going to be a button.
Right. And we probably will push buttons for other people along the way.
Exactly, and that's okay.
Yeah.
It gives us the opportunity either to see that and know that that's something that we're still refining within ourselves,
right.
And or to embrace it with love and say, you know, I'm full of love for you in the moment of challenge that I've created for you.
I love that. That's really fun.
You know, and not get involved in the drama.
Right. You know, the drama is all the head stuff and the ego and the rest of it.
Right, and be the clear, I mean, so it, I don't have to try and defend something that if all I'm doing is being my most authentic self and it pushes a button for someone, I can love them while they work through the button.
Right.
You know, or I can say, okay, and if I have a response, then I look inside myself and see, okay, what's still not healed.
Yeah, exactly. Very good. It seems so simple, and yet...
Well, it's every moment's demand.
Yeah.
It's that simple and that absolutely intense a level of commitment.
Yes, Yes, and a level of awareness and awakeness.
Well, we become aware and awake as we do it.
Yeah.
I mean, all these crystals came to the crystal room and this woman was guided, they were supposed to be here. The first day we were open, this man comes in and he goes, "Merlin appeared to me, I'm supposed to buy crystals here." And we had we established a wonderful relationship. And about 3 or 4 days into knowing each other, he came in and he said, because I'd been working on my structural engineering degree, and he came in and he said, "You know, you really have to do something about your field." And I said, "My field?" And he goes, "Yes, your field. It's almost non-existent. If you're going to be shepherding these crystals, you better be paying attention to your field, because you have to hold your field before you can hold theirs." And so I went into it, and I thought about it, and I said, "Well, you know, that's really true. I've been, you know, when you're trying to get through the calculus rotation and everything, you're not really exactly thinking about, I wasn't thinking about my field."
Right.
You know? And so I actually went into meditation, and I got that I was to go through every one of my chakras, and anything that wasn't in total complete alignment with my source self, first I'd neutralize, and then I used my I Am presence because it makes sense to me, but it doesn't matter, whatever, anything works for anyone. I demand and command that the RNA and DNA, which are code words of existence for anything, not just us, after I neutralize it, so it wouldn't go away, that it would be removed and sent to its highest form of expression.
Okay.
So I neutralize it, then I remove it, and not be allowed to return. Okay, so as I've done that for the last 7-8 years, that's the only thing I'm accepting. And then I recognize my oneness with all it is and pure divine love. I don't have to separate myself out from anyone. I'm only receiving my individual aspect of source. And so initially way back when, where we'd have layer after layer of all these different energy fields that we were protecting ourselves from.
Right.
You know, from what? If
right.
Everything is all it is.
Right.
You know, so in this, I become my individual aspect of source, and as clearly as I can in each moment I'm in, and recognize that everything else is part of what it is to be one with all that is,
yeah.
In whatever way it expresses itself.
Yeah.
And if it gives me an opportunity to shift and respond into my own alignment, it's a blessing. And if it's a beautiful reflection, it's a blessing.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. You should be writing a book on this stuff.
It's a full-time thing to live it.
Yeah, well, of course.
And I usually don't answer a question that isn't asked.
Yeah.
Because who am I answering it for? You know?
Yeah. Well, good, yeah. Now, you mentioned, has he been back and said your field has improved?
Oh, yeah.
Do you ever do
it? No, yeah, definitely. It speaks for itself at this point.
Well, I think so. Yeah. I think so.
Well, and that's the whole thing. To me, it isn't about what we say. Mm-hmm. It's about the energy field that we project.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are days where if I've got like a gazillion things going, it may not be the clearest energy field I can be, but it's the clearest energy field I can be in that moment.
Yeah. And you're aware that that's the way it is, and you're doing the best you can.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's all any of us can do.
And I give everybody else the same consciousness.
Mm. And this certainly removes a lot of the judgment about things, too.
We're all just it gives us the opportunity to love each other for where we are in the moment we're in.
Mm-hmm.
However that looks.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to kind of ask you about how you've seen things shift over the last few years, and if you think that, you know, this is a particularly intense time period. I tend to work with the idea that, you know, we're in some times of change, and we talked about this a little bit earlier, and you know, you said that you've seen that in the people that you've been working with, and as you said, the crystal is showing up now, the 2012 crystal.
Right. And really, again, as a guideline of where we're moving toward, because it's just unlimited freedom and consciousness. without all of the old thought forms, without the limitations, without the gridded structures that, whether they be religious, whether they be politically engineered, whether they be fear-based, whether
financial.
They be...
Financial. It seems there's an awful lot of materialism in the world today.
Well, materialism, again, I think one of the, probably one of my biggest lessons has been not getting caught up in the goodness or badness of the energy field around the material, whether it's financial or whether it's possessions or whether it's however it expresses itself.
Right.
I mean that's probably and because it's energy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so depending on how we use the energy, it can be miraculous or it can be devastating.
Mm-hmm.
So again, intention is everything. Atlantis, the whole thing with Atlantis was losing fact of the balance of that, and taking it into a more power based, fear based separation.
We talked about this being that being another period of harvest or harvest time, a cycle that repeats itself. That we're in now.
We're in the middle of the photon belt. It accelerates everything. It intensifies everything. It is the opportunity to have huge shifts.
Mm.
And sometimes the shifts appear catastrophic. Our experience is catastrophic. And yet the miracles that happen within that catastrophic event are defy imagination simultaneously.
Mm-hmm.
And both reflect the whole.
And by shifting our view of what's happening, quote, out there, it's transforming it as well. If we see everything as being beneficial or constructive in some way as leading to something higher, then it changes the nature of that event.
We don't react against it, deny it, push it away as not part of us.
Right, right. Because that makes it more real.
And it dissolves the separation.
Right, which is what's creating so many of the difficulties that we have today.
Mm-hmm.
The separation. We're moving out of separation duality and into...
unity, one with source consciousness.
Yes.
Right. And in doing that, it's an every moment choice.
Yeah.
It's an every moment. How am I going to look at this? How am I going to receive this absolutely off the wall moment?
Yeah.
You know, that is challenging every cell of my body.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we all have them.
Right.
Yeah. You know.
Yeah, we do. The health is one of those areas that people find stimulates that kind of thought.
And yet, look at the people who get to a point where they choose that they're going to be well.
And they do.
And they shift it.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. The miraculous things, the miraculous to us.
Over and over and over again.
Yes, I'm sure you've seen that a lot with the healers that come in there.
Totally.
Yeah, with using crystals for healing. And
we have a couple master crystals, master healers, that basically we take a picture of the crystal and we take a picture of the person and align it energetically, and if the crystal agrees to work with the person, and... because it may be appropriate for the crystal, for the person to be going through whatever it is to really get through the learning of it,
mm-hmm.
You know. And if it just automatically gets cured,
mm-hmm.
it's just gonna. There's something else that's going to have to come in its place to.
To upset the apple cart.
Exactly. You know.
Exactly.
At this point in time, I try to take care of it as fast as possible.
Right.
So I don't have to go into. You know. I think that's what allows it to move into grace and ease.
Yeah.
If you recognize it in the moment and you don't let it build and build and build.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, that's one of the ways that I've stayed alive for 24 years with HIV and AIDS.
Exactly.
You know, so I'm as healthy as a horse today, and I see myself that way.
Exactly. I had my cousin died of AIDS, I was very fortunate to be with him just before he died, and we had many friends who chose not to, you know, and who moved into a different relationship with themselves and became this incredibly vital expression of that.
Yeah.
You know, so I guess from the time I was little, I didn't feel that, I didn't have a sense of good and bad in that way, of life opportunities. It was, if something was really hard, it was for me an opportunity to dig the well a little deeper so I could hold that much more love.
Yeah. That seems to be one of the ways that many of us have grown quite a bit is by choosing lives that have had quite a bit of challenge, and we just transform it continuously.
Right.
You know, it just seems to be it works, you know.
It works, bottom line.
It does work, you know. I mean, I have been through some deep wells, believe me, you know, with various addictions and so on and so forth, and you know, today I'm free of all those things, and it's in one way it's a miracle, but in another way it was just making a choice in a particular moment in time, and then living it
in every moment in time.
Yes, and believe me, I don't feel that I am responsible for, you know, being alive today, because it feels like...
Because it goes way beyond either one of us.
It's way beyond anything that I can comprehend. I thought I would be dead many years ago.
Right.
So, you know, for the grace of, you know, the source,
right,
all that is, I am still here.
Exactly.
For whatever reason.
Being who you are in this moment.
Right, exactly. And you know...
And being the conduit where your story, your truth can radiate energetically.
Mm-hmm.
It's truth.
Yeah. And it just seemed to find people like yourself that, you know, reflect that truth, and I just enjoy so much hearing and reminding myself, you know, of those deeper truths that I often forget during the course of a day and getting wrapped up in my own little minuscule life and fears and pettiness and so on.
Each moment gives us an opportunity to say yes to the more than, or to contract.
Yes. And sometimes because we're multidimensional, we're doing both at the same time.
Right, and in many different levels.
Yeah.
And that's the mystery of it all. And so is every other aspect of creation.
Yeah.
I mean, every other aspect, the crystals, it the smallest level of particulate matter is living that yes.
Yeah.
And it forms what we know as the table, but it is in service.
Uh-huh.
What we know as the phone, what we know as everything.
Yeah.
And it's just living that gratitude of what it means to be challenged, as well as what it means to know the bliss of being the clearest expression.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't mean that it goes away.
Right.
It just means that it has a different accent of the syllable.
Well, you know, where you're at in Mount Shasta, you have all kinds of mystical things to remind you, you know.
It's a volcano, too, though, but don't forget.
Well, that's true. Now, have you seen it? Isn't that the place where the Lemurians reside, supposedly? Or?
Well, it's an energetic, they're energetically, it's a consciousness, it's a dimension that sometimes enters the physical, but it's easier for them to stay in a higher frequency because of the density that it means to come into our thought forms and our physical.
Oh, yeah.
But we can raise ourselves to that, and many people go inside the mountain and everything, in a higher frequency thought form,
mm-hmm.
rather than necessarily in the physical, although
right.
there have been some that went into the physical. But it's a lot more work for them and a lot more work for us at this point to maintain that.
Mm-hmm. But that gap will diminish, don't you think?
Oh, continually.
As the frequency continues to raise and...
continually.
Yeah. So if we're in the photon belt, what is the projected time frame that we're going to be, you know, this is going to continue to intensify, isn't it, the energetic shifts?
They all do.
They all do.
And I guess my experience is, it depends on what I focus on as to my experience.
Mm-hmm.
So if I don't get involved in the drama,
mm-hmm.
and we've had some huge, huge shifts
mm-hmm.
here at the Crystal Room in this last 6 months.
Really?
Yeah, big shifts. If I could have gotten involved in the drama of it,
uh-huh.
and lived the absolute miracle of it,
huh.
which I did. And everybody talks about how the vibrational field reflects it.
Uh-huh.
You know,
uh-huh.
and it's a matter of how we receive what comes into our moment,
mm-hmm.
and how we respond, how we choose to respond to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, it's that simple.
Mm.
Are we going to respond with as much love and appreciation and embrace whatever it is that is absolutely demanding us to stretch more than might be comfortable,
mm-hmm.
or are we going to push it away, resist it, not accept it, make it bad,
yep.
and have to build up the amity where it comes again and it hits us in the head a little harder,
yeah.
so we pay attention.
Yeah, that does seem to be the bottom line, doesn't it?
Exactly. Well, pragmatically speaking, I've decided that it's easier for me to deal with it in the moment I'm in.
Yeah,
than to just have it build to a point where it's out of control.
Oh, me too. You know, the universe has a way of knocking you on your head, and I've had so many bricks on mine that, you know, I've got scars all over the top of my head.
I know, me too.
Know, and I finally learned that, oh, I can get this lesson right now, or I can have it appear again in a little while that's even worse.
Exactly.
You know, I think I'll learn it now.
I think I will, yeah.
Yeah, I'll try anyway. I'll do my best
yeah.
to learn this lesson.
Let me be open to this one.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, let me try and stretch myself where I don't see it as bad.
Right, right.
Where I can participate in a way that allows me to learn from it.
Yes. Yeah, without judgment and fear and separation and the rest of it.
Right.
Live it up, love it, and...
Whether it's the gas prices.
Right.
Or whatever manifestation it happens to be.
You mentioned one earlier. I won't say it.
Yeah, I know. I was avoiding it, too.
Yeah. Well, great minds think alike. You said something that kind of startled me earlier, and I asked you about UFOs and stuff, and you said, oh, yeah, there. What did you say?
No, I said that well, there we were talking about a bunch of things, but I was
yeah.
talking about, you know, Mount Shasta
yeah.
is a vortex, and it has all different kinds of energy fields that
yeah.
intersect here, and that, like, when, and my significant other doesn't believe any of this.
Uh-huh.
You know, he's and it's okay, because I honestly think we're two different streams of consciousness
right.
that chose to come together to prove it could happen and really love each other. And because, I mean, if it doesn't happen on an individual basis, it can't happen on a global basis.
Yeah, right.
Anyway, he wrote, I think I said it last time, he wrote what he calls the redneck's explanation for crystal magnetism, because he looks upon himself as you know, coming from that point of view and not necessarily prejudice-wise, but as far as having it to have to be basic, down-to-earth, pragmatic, and no woo-woo-y about it.
Right. Nuts and bolts.
And because he wasn't going to give up his worldview to explain what happened around here all the time. You know. Anyway, we were outside with some friends, and it was like a freeway up there of different... I mean, ships and UFOs and everything else like that. And even he had to say that it was there.
You saw them too, huh?
Yeah, exactly, because wow. It was like, it was a trip. It was amazing. That was just one of the times where the veils were lifted, and it was like an L.A. interchange.
Wow.
And you were asking, well, you know, and you said something about not seeing them, and I said, well, you know, there's lots of, it's like a flight path or a ley line path. If you're not on it, you may never see it.
Yeah. Well, I may not be on it because I never seem to see them, and then I think, gee, I must have an awfully low frequency or something.
No, it doesn't have anything to do with frequencies. Honestly, I don't believe it does anyway.
Well, good. Then I can let go of that old ridiculous.
You can definitely
belief.
Let go of that thought form.
Exactly.
If you let go of that thought form, you very well may see them.
I just might, especially after thinking about seeing them like a freeway up there.
Right, because the universe has to give you what you think.
That's right. I may not want to see them after that.
I think if we don't look upon them as foreign, it's not a big deal.
Well, and as you said, you know, you pointed out this is all expressions of consciousness, and it's all a reflection of all that is.
Right, exactly.
And so unless it's hurting us, which, you know, I haven't heard of that too much lately, and if it is, then that's an experience maybe we needed to have to wake us up.
Or maybe it's a reflection of the fear that we have, that we manifest.
Right. And which then attracts things to us.
Exactly.
Yeah. Hmm. So this the man sounds like interesting. They had Merlin talk to him. You must have a lot of interesting people that come into the shop that share their mystical.
We have a lot of interesting people. It's really true. And we have the most basic people you can possibly imagine.
Yeah.
Wonderful families with children that are interested in rocks and minerals. And we have the second graders and fifth graders come every year with their teachers, and we do workshops with them. And,
oh, how wonderful!
It's every level of consciousness, and
wow.
That's the way I like it.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Does anybody startle you with their information anymore? You know, like
me with information.
Like, I'm a Pleiadian such and such from this one, or I'm Arcturian and I'm here to...
No, that's... Believe me, I have a real broad range of normalcy.
Okay.
So most of, I mean, the startledness would be more on the closedness than the openness.
Yeah. Were you surprised to see a 2012 crystal show up in your shop, and how did you recognize it?
Well, this very dear friend of mine who is an unbelievable caretaker of the Crystal Kingdom brought it, and he asked me to, in fact, I'm writing up an... a description of it for his website.
Oh.
But he asked me to see what I thought and take it in and feel it and everything. And after I gave him my descriptions, he told me that he had been given that it was supposed to be called 2012 as a forerunner for us.
Mm.
You know how a lot of times we'll have an experience and it'll be unbelievably clear and unbelievably insightful, and then we have to get into our everyday lives and move into it.
Yeah.
You know, and I think the 2012 consciousness is a lot like that.
Mm.
It's like a pathfinder, a way shower for us, for us as we raise our vibrational frequencies into that consciousness.
And so, in a sense, I get the sense that it's holding the space for us.
Of possibility.
Yes, yeah, but that we're creating that space.
We are that space
are
being
that,
created.
We are 2012, and we are the future.
Exactly.
And the past.
Exactly.
Yeah.
We are it in all now.
Yeah.
In all now, and it's our as we proactively move into the choice of that consciousness, we are it.
Yes, and we start to align with more and more with the now of what we presently consider to be a future time.
Right. Well, there is no... It's really interesting. The 77 vibration is the beginning of it in Melody, when in Melody's description is transcending the concept or transcending the... the thought form of advancement.
Mm-hmm.
When we transform, when we transform that consciousness of advancement,
mm-hmm.
there is there's only the now.
Mm-hmm.
It's in our master numbers. It's transcendence of the creation of advancement.
Okay. Is this from a book?
Hmm?
Is this from a book? Or?
Yeah, it's Love is in the Earth by Melody.
Oh, okay.
And that's in her master number. She's a mathematician, so she tends to be mathematician wordy.
Okay.
But nonetheless, the transcendence of the creation of advancement. When we transcend the creation of advancement, there is only the now.
Wow, I like that. Well, that's a good place for us to move into the now of the end of the show.
That's true.
And before we go, would you just tell people what your website is so they can take a look and check it out and see some of these amazing things and get in touch with you?
Sure. www.crystalsmountshasta.com. So MTSHASTACRYSTALS. MTSHASTA.com. And our website is crystals at crystalsmountchester.com.
Wonderful. And people can just get in touch with you personally.
Mm-hmm. And just, exactly.
Well, it's such a wonderful shop. I love going there, and I look forward to the next time I'm able to come by and say hello in person.
It'll be wonderful to be with you again.
Oh, and thanks so much, Beverly, for being
many blessings.
I just love you.
I love you, too, and many blessings to all that have been listening.
Good night, everybody, and good night, Beverly.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to A Fireside Chat with Zany Mystic. I am your host, Lance, and I have some quartz crystals and some other ones, and my own feeling is that, you know, I just let them be. Now, I may not know precisely what purposes they serve. Some of them are quite extraordinary. If I have a chance to bring some of these up and ask you next time, or of course, you can douse these too, can't you?
Mm-hmm.
Using the yes-no function. But they're beautiful crystals, and some rutilated quartz. I have a clear quartz crystal here, and I have a couple of Herkimer diamonds, and, you know, I love them, so...
Exactly.
I don't care what they're...
Well, and basically they're working with you.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And as far as clearing and cleansing them...
Oh, yeah.
For me, the easiest way to do it with any crystal or any mineral is with using cosmic gold and its essence colors. But first I blaze it with a violet flame or clear it. You can neutralize and remove anything that isn't in its highest good,
mm-hmm.
in its highest form of expression.
Mm-hmm.
But if a crystal wants to take a bath, I'll give it a bath, don't get me wrong. but I very rarely use a salt solution or anything. For some crystals, it's very damaging. For some minerals, it's very damaging.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I rarely use a...
like a sea salt.
A type of cleansing aspect.
Right.
I use energy and intention. And then after I've cleared it, I use cosmic gold.
Uh-huh.
And the easiest way for me to describe cosmic gold is to go outside in the sun with something gold, and there's this absolute shimmer that hovers above it, and that's the close. It's like an iridescent shimmer, and it's like the old gold fireworks.
Oh yeah.
And that's the easiest way I can describe cosmic gold.
From your viewpoint, what is one of the best ways to program? And then, what about cleansing crystals?
Well, I know people are involved in programming crystals, and using the same work, if the crystal does the same work, to me, it isn't in the crystal's or the person's best interest to try and program a crystal that doesn't do that work.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Okay? So that's not being respectful, and it just is like asking someone who is, you know, doesn't know how to tap dance to tap dance. Anyway, but the... This is our train.
Oh, I love
this. This is Mount Shasta.
I love the sound of the train.
Anyway.
We're right there at Mount Shasta, so go on.
So basically, when a crystal does the same work, you can set the intention that it facilitate you in whatever way that is.
Okay.
And that would be, you know, asking it. I don't see, in my worldview, programming has the connotation that we're better than it is and it's supposed to do what we want it to do.
Right.
You know, and I don't have that thought form.
Right.
So to me, it's a co-partnership. Once you work with a crystal that really does your work,
uh-huh.
you co-partner with it in doing it. So it's taking on certain tasks that, or accents and focuses on certain tasks that you're going to, like a quartz crystal is a really good transmitter.
Uh-huh.
So you want to transmit that consciousness through it. It is just using it in the way that it does, that it works.
Yeah.
You know, the same way that we pick up a telephone and we talk to each other on the phone.
Right.
It isn't, we don't have to make the telephone be a telephone to do that.
Right. That makes sense to me. I have some crystals. I had cleansed them. I actually left them out way too long. They were over-baked out in the sun and in the moon and the rain and everything. But I brought them back, and that was the, you know, what's going on with the shifts in energies and consciousness, and, you know, from what your experience, what have you seen over the years, and what do you see arriving, and also about the concept of the Mayan prophecy about 2012 being the peak of that period.
Well, 2012 is as far as the consciousness covered from where it was being written. Okay, so for me, it is a huge shift, and actually there's a new crystal that's come in that is actually termed 2012 that has a level of consciousness that defies imagination.
Really?
And it really they're very simple. They're not big, elaborate crystals, but they hold that absolute, it's a freedom. It's an unlimited consciousness.
Oh.
Freedom that I think we're moving toward in the shift.
Uh-huh.
That we're in now, as we let go of the old ways, old thoughts, old forms, and we move into what I call true creatrix compliance. Creatrix meaning it's not about creator, it's not about creatress. That's in the split, but it's as a unified consciousness that isn't split, and that X at the end kind of represents that unified consciousness as one.
Oh.
And so as we move into that consciousness and we let go of the old ways, old means, separations, traditional reactions rather than actions, we're moving into a new paradigm. We're moving into a new frequency inner relationship with all that is.
Mm.
And taking in on our creative co-partner, and then you don't have to know its essence colors. It knows its essence colors. You just give the intention that it receives it.
Right, and they've been around long before we were.
Right,
and will be around after we're here.
Exactly.
So to them, we're just like a flash of a light bulb going off. If that.
Exactly, and but they appreciate and love our consciousness. And very often through lifetimes, we work with similar crystals, if not the same crystals, depending on the crystal.
They use those in, I read in stories about Atlantis and the rest, that they were using crystals for advanced technology
So are we. Yeah,
But it we're not using them to the extent that they were used then, are we?
Or thank God.
Yeah, that kind of brought their civilization down, didn't it?
Well, the consciousness brought the civilization down.
Okay.
And it's in for me. We've had cycle after cycle after cycle. From one consciousness level to another consciousness level,
uh-huh.
one part of the earth, China, another part of the earth, the Egyptian, another part of the Earth, Mid-Eastern, another part of the Earth, every single part of the Earth, the Himalayas, as that culture developed in the Mayans, as that culture developed the Quetzalcoatl in Mexico, as that culture developed and then seemed to recede, it looks like a loss. But in kind of in my worldview, it's like the Earth having all those parts activated. Now we're at a point where we activate the whole. She's activating herself as a whole, and we're activating ourselves as whole world consciousness.
So now that kind of brings us into the, you know, the general topic that I wanted to get into tonight. Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to A Fireside Chat with Zany Mystic. I am your host, Lance White. Tonight, I'm delighted to have Beverly Wilson return for part two of our exploration into the crystalline realms. Beverly is the owner of Mount Shasta's Middle Earth, the Crystal Room. She teaches classes and instructs people from around the world. And tonight, we're going to explore, among other things, what the crystals and others are sharing about the present shifts in energies and consciousness, along with some projections about the Mayan prophecies about 2012. So let's welcome Beverly to the show now, and I will say hi, Beverly. How are you?
Great. It's great to be back.
Oh, good. Wonderful. Well, before we get digging into some deeper topics, maybe you could just briefly get us started by an overview of what crystals are and how their consciousness can guide us.
Well, physics has, besides indigenous cultures, physics has proved that they're living consciousness. And what we do at the Crystal Room is just have the crystals' work be as important as the person's work. And so what we're doing is like shepherding the person to get together with the crystal that does the same work they do. And at that point in time, then whether the crystal and the person works with planets, solar systems, galaxies, universes, angelic realms, interdimensional, it doesn't matter. The work that they're doing and the scope that with which they have that work matches with the with the crystal, and they both get to be optimum to what they do.
Yeah, wow. Now, on a practical level, I didn't ask you this the last time, but this is a real simple thing that I'm sure people wonder about, and we each have our different answers and solutions to it, but